Genzo Gyozi Nozuki no Hanashi desu. Gyozi no ge, sengetsu dewa Daruma san no hanashi ga owatte, kongetsu kara wa taiso eka. Nisou desu ne, nisou no hanashi ni hairimasu. Iwanami Bunko dewa 363ページ、終わりから3行目のところです。今画面に映っているのは、インターネットで見れる正文字、の正法現像です。この間も紹介しましたけれども、知らない人は、まあ、ローマ字で正文字を入れて、まあ、正法現像を入れると出てくるかな、正法現像。出てこない。まあ、日本語で正法現像入れれば必ず出てくる。So if you're looking for the 正法現像 in the original Japanese on the internet, you would type in 正文字 with Latin letters and 正法現像 in Japanese, and there it is.Today's part would be here, Gyozi. Starting at the top of the page, Shindan Dai Nisou. Mazu genbu no yonde ikimasu. Shindan Dai Nisou, Taiso Shoushu Fukaku Daishi wa Jinki tomo ni kyoubo su.同族同じく尊重せし高徳の祖なり高達の師なりイラクに急遽して軍書を博覧す国のまれなりとするところ人の間愛がたきなり方向特重のゆえに人物祝言して、祖に語りて言う。まさに儒家を思わば、なんぞここに滞るや、大路東起にあらず。何時それ南へ行くべし。まずここまで読みます。As you know, English translation is on the internet or in the library, Nishijima. This would be Nishijima, today's spot is... Last month we finished the part about Bodhidharma. Today we start with the section about the second patriarch. Would be here.There's a 214 in brackets. Taiso, the second patriarch in China, titled Great Master Shoushu Fukaku, was a teacher of lofty virtue and a man of erudition. Adored by both gods and demons, and esteemed by both monks and laymen, he lived for many years between the rivers Yi and Laku, during which time he widely read various books.He was considered to be one of the country's rare individuals, the like of whom a person could not easily meet. Because of his eminence in Dharma and the weight of his virtue, a mystical being suddenly appeared and told the patriarch, "If you want to reap the fruit of your efforts, why do you linger here? The great truth is not far away. You must go south." And next, I would like to take.A look at the original. ここは、岩波文庫の方は新字で書かれているのが見やすいんですけれども、正文字では、旧字です。So if you want to take a look at the original Japanese, you have the option here on the internet, but the disadvantage with that is that it uses the old style characters, which are sometimes more complicated.If you look at the Iwanami Bunko version, which we have in the library, today's section would be on page 362. The advantage here is you have simpler characters, and also you have furigana, which you don't have here. But, well, anyway, shindan, the first two characters, that's a little bit difficult, because that you will hardly find in a normal dictionary. It means, basically, it means China. It's an old word for China, just like the old word for India is Tenjiku. So whenever you see Tenjiku, which is also strange, two characters, if you look them up separately, you will never find the meaning. Tenjiku is India, Shindan is China. Shindan. Dai Ni So. So that's pretty straightforward. Dai Ni means number two, so is the patriarch or ancestor. So the second patriarch in China. And then comes the name of the patriarch, Tai So Sho Shu Fukaku. Usually we call him Eka, Tai So Eka, but he has several names. His name is a lame and obviously was Shinko, and this is another Dharma name, Sho Shu Fukaku Taishi. この小数深く大使は、まあ、大層エカの別名のようです。そして人口という名前、神の光と書いて人口という呼び方も、ダルマさんに会う前にはあったようです。ここには人口という言葉が出てきませんが、神田は中国のことで、そこの2番目の祖。 の大祖、小州深く大師についての話です。彼が、まあ、立派な人で、人気ともに凶暴す。神も鬼も彼に憧れていた彼を非常に敬ってたという話です。 So first, Dogen Zenji starts with a legend that he probably takes from the Gyoji chapters based on several records. One is called Koso Den, a Chinese records of biographies of monks. Ketoku Dento Loku is another record that also today's section is based on. Ketoku Dento Loku, the transmission of the lamp, it's usually translated into English. And in Sotoshu we also have the transmission of light, Denko Loku by Keiran Zenji. It's basically it's taking the title from the Denko Loku and changes it a little bit around. Those are two records of biographies of famous monks, and Dogen Zenji is using a lot of those sources, also in today's texts. So according to the Dento Loku, Jinki means gods and demons had high respect for the second patriarch. Dōzoku onajiku sonju seshi. Obōsan dake dewa naku zaike no hito mo kono eka o hijou ni sonkei shiteita. Sonkei shiteita hodo koutoku no so である. それだけ徳の高い人であった。光達のしなり。水野八百子さんはこれについて心が広々として物事に通達していることというふうに説明してくれてます。
イラク、イラクというのはどちらも川の、名前らしい、伊水と落水。で、この二つの川の間に彼が長く住み続けて、軍書を博覧する、あらゆる書物に目を落としになったと言われています。まあ、道元禅師も、中国に渡る前には、 大蔵経は3遍ぐらい読んだらしいですけれども、その他にも、儒教の書物、道教の書物、あらゆる書物に目を通してたと言われている。同じように、この大祖エカも
ダルマさんに出会う前には非常に、よくよく勉強して広くいろんなものに目を通したそうです。So the biography says that Taisho Eka was respected by gods and demons and both laymen and monks for his high virtue. He stayed somewhere between the rivers, which names are in Japanese I and Laku. I guess in Chinese they would be pronounced differently. And they say that he had studied a lot of scriptures, not only Buddhist scriptures, but also Confucian and Taoist scriptures. Next, in the Japanese original, you find a lot of hiragana. Sometimes you have these hiragana and then it becomes a little bit more confusing as if you would use the kanji. Here, for example, kuni. In hiragana, it's basically the country. Kuni is a word that you use a lot, even today in Japanese. So kuni no would be belonging to the country. And male, nari, male means to be something rare. Kuni no male nari to suru tokoro. So he had something that was rare in the country. So even the whole country of China, he was an exceptional person. It's basically what this phrase is saying here. Kuni no male nari to suru tokoro, hito no ai gataki nari. Hito, very simple here, person. Aigataki, so here a little bit complicated because you have this he, which you have to, in your mind, change it to a he, I. And then it becomes today's Japanese, to ao means to meet somebody. And aigatai means like aligatai or aligato. Thank you. Aligato means something that's hard. Ali means to be. So well, people usually explain the root of this word, aligato, means it's hard for me to exist in the face of this favor that you're doing for me. You're doing this favor for me, it's really hard for me to be here. So, aligatai. Do we have any other Japanese phrases with a gatai, katai?
Is it just inikui? Shigatai? Shigatai? Something to
shigatai. Yes, shigatai. Shigatai. Exactly. Shinikui. Would be the same. You know, basically, it's something that is hard, and ai gataki means then hard to meet. So, shito. In this phrase here, hito no aigataki nari. Nari, again, as John asked last time, nari would be de'aru, today, or des, in the polite version that you hear all the time. And in the Kamakura time, instead of des or de'aru, you use nari. So here, this phrase, or the whole sentence. Kuni no male nari to suru tokoro. Someone rare in the whole country. Hito no aigataki nari, a person that is hard to meet, somebody that's hard to find. And it's all in hiragana. It's pretty easy to get the meaning if you know a certain amount of Japanese. Kuni no male nari to suru tokoro hito no aigataki nari. Hōkō tokuju no yue ni jinmotsu shukugen shite so ni katarite yu. Koko kara chotto ma fushigi na hanashi ni natte kimasu. Yosuni amari ni mo toku no takai hito de atta tame ni jinmotsu shukugen shite, ma kamisama no yōna. 水野八百子さんに言わしたら、不思議なものがたちまちに現れてと。神のようなものが現れて、大祖エカに語りかけた。Here again, the disadvantage with this Shomonji version is that you have some characters like this, that are reproduced as pictures. This is basically the character for Toku. Toku means virtue. Ho is the Dharma, Ko is high, this is the virtue, this is means heavy. So it means that he had high dharmic virtue, also a certain weight because of that. So basically he was a person of high, so high virtue that Jim Motsu Shuku Genshite. So here starts a little bit a funny part of the story. It sounds a little bit like a fairy tale. There was something like a deity, a god that appeared out of nowhere. And so here again as a picture is the character for patriarch Katalite Yu. Yu today would be written with E-U, means to speak, and in the old days it was E-Fu, although it's still pronounced Yu. So because he had so high virtue, there came a deity, appeared out of nothing and spoke to the second patriarch. And what he spoke in the original, it's all Chinese, this phrase here. But because it's hard to read like this, in brackets you have the Japanese. This is basically the Japanese reading of this Chinese phrase. And if you look at this at the Iwanami Bunko, they also tell you, because of the furigana, how to read it. Masani juka o omowaba nanzo koko ni todokoru ya daido toki ni arazu nanji sore minami e yuku beshi. Kore wa kono fushigi na kami no you na mono ga totsuzen arawarete taisoika ni katatta mono desu ne. Anata ga juka, yousuni nihan no koto desu ne. Nihan o etai to omou naraba, ma moto kurakete yu narabe, moto anata ga jibun no honto no mondai o kaiketsu shitai to omou naraba, naze koko ni todomaru koto ga dekiru no ka to. あなたには解決しなければいけない問題があるはず。ここで何をのんびりとぽーっとやっているのかということですね。なんぞここにを滞るや大道陶器にあらず。大道は大いなる道でもあり、あのくたら三脈三菩提のことでもあるんですね。あなたの問題解決が遠いところにあるのではない。何時それ南へ行くべし、南へ行きなさいと、ある不思議なものが、アドバイスをしてくれた。So this DT, what did he say to the second patriarch? まさに塾か思わば。So if you are looking for the solution of your problem, 塾か、well, how did Nishijima translate it? It's basically the result of practice or something. You could also translate it as attaining nirvana, but basically it's the solution of the problem. If you're interested in the solution of your problem, how can you stay there where you are right now? How can you sit there with your books? Daido toki ni arazu. Daido is the big way, but it also means great nirvana. Great nirvana is not far away. You should go south. So, as a Zen monk, you would expect him. It's right there where you're now, right below your feet. But he doesn't say that. The DT says you need to go south. Not too far away, but don't stay where you are right now. In the place where you are right now, you won't find the solution. You need to head south. And then it continues here. Akuruhi would be the next day, the following day. So you fu ni iwarete, まだその時はエカという名前ではなくて、おそらく人工という名前だった、あるいは少子不覚という名前だったのか、人工だったんでしょう。あくる日ににわかに頭痛すること、さすがごとし。刺すような、針が刺すような頭痛が急に起きたと。あくる日、にわかに、にわかに is also an expression that you still find today in Japanese, although not with a ha, but with a wa. にわかに、にわか雨 means a sudden rain, for example. If it starts to rain suddenly, that would be にわか雨. And in this case, it's 頭痛. This is also a word that you still find in today's Japanese, 頭痛 is headache. So the next day, out of a sudden, he experienced a headache. 頭痛すること、さすがごとし、さす means to be stung by a thorn or something. So he had this pain that's like being stung by something sharp, a stabbing pain. The next day, he experienced a stabbing headache. その死、落葉幽門鉱山北条禅師。その時の師匠のことです。So he visited the teacher that he was studying with at the time. The Chinese name pronounced in the Japanese way would be 落葉幽門鉱山北条。これを治せんとするときに、So his teacher tried to help him with the pain, but これを治せんとするとき、when he tried to cure his headache. Again, there's a Chinese phrase here, but you have the Japanese reading in brackets.
空中に声ありて曰く。
You heard something from outer space, so he didn't see whoever was talking there, but you heard this voice from out of space. 空中. Ku means also emptiness, but in this case it would be space.
空中に声ありて.
There was a voice in the middle of space, and it said,
空中に声ありて曰く。これすなわち骨を凍るなり、常の痛みにあらず。
And his skull bone is changing its shape. So basically the source of the pain is that his skull bone is changing its shape. It's not a usual headache.
これは普通の痛みではないぞと。骨が形を変えている。
そしてまた漢文が続くんです。Again, there's a Chinese section followed by the Japanese here.
そう。これはあの体操絵画ですね。師匠が空中からそういう声を聞いたときには、この体操絵画が、自分の師匠に伝えた。そう。ついに見物の字を持って死に申す。師匠に対して、実は先ほど神のような不思議な存在に出会ったということを伝えた。
So when his teacher heard this voice from out of space, 太祖エカ told his teacher that he had just met this strange deity.
死、この頭骨を見るに、すなわち御法の収出せるがごとし。そこで師匠がよくよく自分の弟子、つまり太祖絵画の、頭のてっぺんを見ていったら、御法の収出せるがごとし、なんか五つの山のようなポコッと五つ山のようなものが できているというのが見えた。And then the teacher looked at Eko's skull and saw that at the top of the skull there was something like 5 small heaps appearing. すなわちいわく、何時がそう吉祥なり、まさに諸々あるべし。神の何時南へ行くというは、これすなわち少林寺のダルマ大師必ず何時が死なり。And when he saw this shape on the top of the skull, he said, すなわちいわく何時がそう吉祥なり。これは非常に、まあ、ありがたいお姿である。That is an auspicious sign on your head.まさに諸々あるべし、水野八子さんに言わせれば神が憐れていたことの証はきっとあるであろう、要するに頭がこうなっているということは神様の言ったことは嘘ではない証である、Looking at the head of his disciple, the teacher decides that what this Diki told must be the truthまさに諸々あるべし。神の何時南へ行くというは、それすなわち少林寺のダルマ大師必ず何時が死なり。So if that God told you to go south, then he must have meant Bodhidharma in Shaolin. And that this Bodhidharma is going to be your teacher.おそらく神が言いたかったのは、南へ行けという言葉で言いたかったのは、少林寺にいるダルマさんがあなたの本当の師匠となるであろうということだと。And next, in the Shomonji page would be here. この、again, this is a funny picture for the character Oshie. Oshie is a quite simple or often used character. この Oshie を聞きて。聞きてです。Would be in Japanese, today's Japanese, kite, kono oshie o kite. Kamakura Japanese, it's kono oshie o kite. Kono oshie o kite, so, sunawachi, shoshitsu ho ni sanzu. Shisho no kono hanashi o kite, nochi no taiso eka wa, sugu ni shorinji.少林寺の別の呼び方としては消失法とここで出てますけれども、すぐにこの少林寺に向かった。 When Eka, who at this time was still called Jinko, heard these words from his teacher, he decided to start right away and go to Shaolin. Which is called here in the text Shoshitsu Ho, but it basically means the same thing. 神は自らの愚音主導の主導人なり。これは先ほどの不思議な神様のような存在について言われているけれども、この神は何だったかというと、これは大祖エカの、まあ、守護神のような存在であった。もう大昔から、ひょっとして前世の前世、また前世からの守護神であったと。彼の修行をずっと見守ってた神様であった。So, who was this mysterious deity? According to the text, it was something like a guardian angel of Taiso Eka, who had guarded his practice probably from previous lifetimes on.この時、九老観点なり。ここから話が具体的な少林寺でダルマさんに入門をお願いする、弟子入りをお願いする場面に急に変わるわけです。From here, the story turns to, well, the famous episode of the second patriarch asking the first patriarch in China, Bodhidharma, for permission
to become his student and to be taught. この時、九郎観点なり、九郎観点、水野八子さんでは12月の寒い日、九郎が12月のことでしょうか。そうではないと思いますね。12月は次の文に出てきます。九郎観点、まあ、とにかく非常に寒かったということですね。So this sentence starts out with stating that it was a really cold day. この時九郎観点なり。12月、so December, although in the old lunar calendar, December would probably be more like January. 12月初夜という。So they say it was the night, the early night of the ninth day of the 12th month. So which would be in 2 day solar calendar sometime in January. So the coldest time of the year. 天台右折ならずとも新山広報の当屋は思いやるに人物の騒然に立志すべきにあらず。天台右折ならずとも、まあ大雨や大雪が降っていなかったとしても、ああいう深い山の高い峰の冬の夜は思うに、人が屋外で立つようなそういう状態ではなかったはず。あの少林寺の12月の夜はとてもじゃないけれども、屋外で一人長時間立つようなそういう場合ではない。天台右折 means big rain or big snow ならずとも。 So even if there would have been no big rain or big snow, 深山 deep in the mountains, 後方 high up on the peaks,Toya means winter night. So the winter night, deep in the mountains or high up on the peaks, 思いやるに、when you think about it, 人物の騒然に立志すべきにあらず。It's not the kind of night where you would, as a human being, want to stand outside in front of a window, even if it's not raining or snowing. You don't want to stand in the winter night deep in the mountains outside. 畜節なおはす恐れつべき事故なり、竹でも凍って破ってしまうようなそういう恐ろしい季節である。 It's the time of the year where even bamboo freezes and bursts. In Antaishi, the bamboo rarely bursts in the winter. They kind of usually fall over. But I could imagine that if it gets even colder, that sometimes the water inside the bamboo freezes and bursts. Although in such cold regions, probably there's no bamboo. That happens too often. Or maybe Dogenzenji just means that the bamboo is kind of going down under the snow. Anyway, even for the bamboo, it's a hard time of the year.しかあるに、大雪小地埋線木法なり。 So even if it wouldn't be raining or snowing, it's a hard time of the year, but しかあるに、大雪小地 heavy snow was covering the soil, Maisen Boppo Nadi, and the mountain peaks were buried under the snow, big snow. Yama wa kono hi yuki ni omorete itta. Yuki ga futte nakutemo, totemo janai kedomo, soto ni tatsu yona are janai nda kedomo, kono yoru wa 12月の9日の夜は大雪で山がすべて埋もれ尽くされていたと。破折して道を求む幾ばくの艱難なりとかせん。破産、雪をかき分けてと水野陽子さんが、言う。その道のないところで自分で道を作る。今私たちはまあスノーシューズとか漢字機持っているけど、その当時はおそらくまあ今日のような今のようなスノーシューズはなかったはず。それでも自分で深い雪の中で道を求めて行くばくの艱難なりとかせん、大変であったと。まあ、冒険どころじゃない、もう遭難してもおかしくない危険を犯していったはずである。in this kind of weather in the night, the second patriarch by himself went through the snow to find his way. We can only imagine the hardship that meant for him at the time. ついに素質に閉ずくといえども日室許されず、コメンせざるがごとし。素質というのは道元禅師じゃなくて、ダルマさんがこもってた洞窟のことですね。ついにダルマさんの面壁された洞窟に到着することはできたけれども、やがて着いたと思ったら日室許されず、入ることを許されない。コメンせざるがうとし、振り向いてさえもらえない。こっちへ振り向いてすらくれないと。 And finally the second patriarch reached, well, they say it was a cave, well, we don't know if it was a cave, sometimes it's called a caveHere it's called a room, the room of Bodhidharma, the room of the patriarch. Finally, he's reaching the room of the patriarch, but he's not allowed to enter the room. Bodhidharma wouldn't even turn his head. この夜、この夜、眠らず、座せず、休むことなし。Right now we are here. この夜、この夜、again, would be the same in present day Japanese, この夜, this night, the night we're talking about. 眠らず would be basically 眠らず, not to sleep. The bu and mu sometimes change. I think we have the same thing also in, sometimes in European languages. But bu and mu change, although I don't have a good example right now.Also, another kind of sound that's close to that is the European V, like V and M and V. They're all very close to each other. So, nebulazu is nebulazu, basically. Kono yoru, nebulazu zasezu yasumu koto nashi. Pretty straightforward Japanese. This night, he neither slept, nor sat down, nor rested at all. Pretty forward, even if you read it as present day Japanese.賢竜不動にして悪路を待つに、や切情けなきがごとし。固まってずっと棒のように動かないで立って行って、次の朝明るくなるのを待った。ところが、夜節に情けがなかったと。まあ、当たり前。夜の積もり続ける雪は、 全く大層以下のことを考えもしない。心身とどんどんどんどん深く積もっている。堅守不動。So he stood firm without moving and waited for the day to become light again. He was waiting for the next morning. But the night snow had no empathy for him, of course, because it's snow. So continued to snow all through the night. And the snow didn't have any pity on the second patriarch. Yaya tsumorite koshi o uzumu aida otsuru namida teki teki koru. Yaya tsumorite koshi o uzumu aida. So, mo koshi made tsumotta toki ni kare no namida ga itteki mata itteki ochita to. The snow continued to fall, and at one point he stood in the snow up to his hips. And at that point, one tear after the other started to drop from his eyes. Otsuru namida teki teki koru. And were freezing, actually. Well, the tears that dropped from his eyes one by one started to freeze, even his tears started to freeze. Namida o miru ni namida o kasane. When he saw his tears freezing, he cried even harder. Mi o kaeri mite, mi o kaeri miru. So he reflected upon himself and once more reflected upon himself. Mi o kaeri miru means to basically, mi is the body, kaeri miru looks to look back. Mi o kaeri mite, and then it repeats the same thing again. Mi o kaeri mite. So he saw his drops freezing and cried even harder and reflected, started to reflect upon himself. Mi o kaeri mite, mi o kaeri miru. Jiui suraku. Jiui, mizu no yaoku san wa mizu kara omon miru. Soko de maa jibun de naishin de kangaeta wake. And he thought to himself at this time. Again, a Chinese phrase followed in brackets by the Japanese reading. Mukashi no shito, michi o moto muru ni, hono uchite zui o tori. Chi o sashite, uetaru o suku. Kami o shikite dei o oi, kishi ni nagete tora ni kau. Inishie nao kaku no gotoshi, wale mata nambitozo. So this is what he thought to himself when his tears started to freeze in the cold. In the past, there were those who were looking for the way and they were smashing their bones to get the mark out of the bones. Or they drew the blood from their body to feed others. There were those who spread out their hair in the mud. And there were those who threw themselves from cliffs to feed tigers. If that is what those in the past did, who am I? Wale mata nambito so. Who am I? これはいずれも、まあ、過去の菩薩の話、有名な話もあればそれほど有名でもない話もあるけれども、この骨を砕いて髄を取ったのは多分バラモンになんかお前の骨髄が欲しいとか言われて、じゃあ差し上げましょうと言って自分の
炎を砕いてバラモンに粒の骨髄を与えた菩薩もいれば、どうもお腹が空いたというものがいるから、自分の献血じゃないけれども、自分の血を、自分の体を刺して血を取って、そのお腹の空いた人に与えた菩薩の話もある。髪を敷いたという話は、これはお釈迦様より昔の、仏が、足元の悪いところを通ろうとしたときは、この仏をこの足元の悪いところを通させたら申し訳ないと言って、泥の中に自分の髪の毛を敷いて、まあ、カーペットのように通れるようにしたという話がある。岸に投げて虎に顔、これは有名な話で、摂産同時、だったと思いますけれども、まあ、釈尊のシリーズに起こった話で、この岸の下の虎が菩薩に真理を教えてあげましょう。ただ前半、ただでは前半しか教えない。で、その前半を聞いた後には後半も知りたい。それならばお前の命をくれというんですね。じゃあ、教えてくれたら私は命は差し上げますと言って、教えてもらって、それを木に刻んだり、岩に刻んでから、岸から自分を投げて虎の餌になったという、その有名な話だったと思います。So these examples of past bodhisattvas, some of them are very famous, others are less famous. Basically, I think it was a Brahmin who asked somebody to have the mark of his bones, and that person said, well, if you ask for it, I'll give it to you. And he smashed his bones, gave this Brahma the mark of his bones. And there's another example of someone who wanted to feed according to the commentary here, it was a deity. There was a hungry deity, and a bodhisattva decided, well, I have to feed this deity. And so he cut his body and drew the blood from his body to give to this deity. Then there's the story of an old legendary Buddha who lived before the time of Shakyamuni, who was walking in a muddy area. And a bodhisattva, all of these bodhisattvas are, according to legends, are, how do you say, previous incarnations of Shakyamuni. So before Shakyamuni was born, as Shakyamuni, he was these bodhisattvas in different lifetimes. So in one of his lifetimes, the Shakyamuni saw a Buddha walk through the mud, and he said, well, I can't let this Buddha walk through the mud. So he was a layman at the time, so he put his hair in the mud so that the Buddha could walk on the hair and wouldn't get his feet dirty. And then there's the story of a bodhisattva throwing himself from the cliffs to feed a tiger. I think the story behind that was that the bodhisattva was looking for the truth, and this tiger said, well, I can teach you the truth, but I will give you only the first half for free. And he gave him the first half of that, which was basically all things are impermanent, even including yourself. And then the bodhisattva said, well, I want to hear the second half of that too. And then the tiger says, well, if you want to hear the second half, I want your life. You have to give your life, otherwise I don't teach you the second half. The bodhisattva said, yeah, okay, but please, well, first give me the truth so I can write it down on the trees or on the rocks for later generations, and then I will give you my life. So you have the second part, which was something like, if you let go of the self, and I'm kind of freely interpreting, you know, but if you get
You let go of the self and accept impermanence as it is, you would realize that nirvana is already there in that moment of letting go. And hearing that sentence, he writes it down and then throws himself off the cliff to feed that tiger, as promised. And basically what Dogen is saying here, the second patriarch, when he stood there in the snow and he was crying because it was so cold, who was thinking of these examples of old bodhisattvas, and in the end he says to himself, well, if even the persons of old went so far in their search for the way, who am I? Who am I to complain about the cold in the winter?昔の人がここまでやったならば、ここで寒い寒いと嘆いている自分ってそもそも何なんだと、何様のつもりで寒い寒いと言って涙を流しているんだろうと、昔の人に見習わないといけない。格のごとく思うに、しきいよいよ現地あり。そうして自分の志を高くし、自分で自分を励ました。In this way, he aroused his motivation and inspired himself. 今言う故障にゃくし、がゆう家臣を万心も忘れざるべきなり。このように昔の人なおそこまでやったならば、この私は何様のつもりなのか、そういうふうに自分を振り返ってみて反省して自分を励ます。これは万心、要するに、今日の私たちも同じように反省すべきである。In the same way as the second patriarch reflected upon himself and said, well, if even the people in the old did so much, who am I to complain? We should learn from this and today remind ourselves of our own practice. We shouldn't forget that today. しばらくこれを忘るとき、用語の沈着あるなり。If you forget it, also, you will sink and drown for a long, long time. これを忘れてしまうと、沈着して溺れてしまう。自分の弱さを言い訳にして、甘えてしまおう。水野八百子さんは永遠に浮かび上がれないことという。過去のごとく自炊して法を求め、道を求むる地域の身の身重なる。地域のみ重なる。核のごとく自炊して法を求め、道を求むる地域のみ重なる。創設の創を創とせざるによりて、しかありけるなるべし。地名の夜の消息、はからんとするに簡単も、くだけぬるがごとし。ただ、辛抱の勘破せらるるのみなり。創設は心の汚染を洗いすすぐこと。そういう行事の創設さえもしなかった雪の。創設の創を創とせざるによりて、しかありけるなるべし。 地名の夜の消息図らんとするに簡単も砕けぬるがごとし。ここちょっと英語でどういうふうに訳しているのか確認しておきたいと思います。There is a sentence here where I would like to know how Nishijima translates it. Basically, what we're talking about right now is here in this area, there's a small 139A at the site. As Taisho Ekwa thought thus to himself, his determination to pursue the Dharma and to pursue the state of truth only deepened. Perhaps he was like this because he did not see the means of purity as a means. Perhaps he was like this because he did not see the means of purity as a means. I don't know if you can make much of that English. In the original Japanese, it's also quite difficult. So setsu no so o so to sezaru niyori te shika aru keri naru beshi. So setsu no so o so to sezaru niyori te. Mizuno Yaoko-san wa so setsu wa koko no ose no arai susugu koto, so yu gyouji no sesso sae mo shinakatta. The Iwanami Bunko commentary is written by a lady scholar called Mizuno Yaoko, and she says sōsetsu means to purify the mind, which would be Nishijima. He's also talking about purity. He did not see the means of purity as a means. Sōsetsu no sō o sō to sezaru. So basically, he's not even purifying the mind. He's at one point he even stops to try to purify the mind. Sōsetsu no sō o sō to sezaru. He gets to the point where it's not about purifying the mind anymore. It kind of reminds me a little bit in Uchiyama Roshi's opening the Hand of Thought. There's this famous illustration where he explains the Zen with this line here. I think this is zero something or something. Basically, this line would be the here and now. And Zazen means that we're basically here now with the body and the mind. It's just that what happens is that your mind goes somewhere. There's a thought. What do you do when you realize you're thinking? You go back where you are. You return to, well, if you have some object of meditation, like with the breath, it gets easier. But usually we don't restrict it to the breath. It could be the whole physical perception, but basically the idea is that you return to reality and all of its aspects. So you return to visual perception, there's the acoustic perception, there's everything happening in this body from the tip of your head to the sole of your feet, there's the breath, there's maybe some smell, there's maybe some taste in your mouth. Basically you return to all of that. And sometimes it happens that you don't realize right at once. So I think Uchiyama, he was painting a picture of some sweet girl here. So you're thinking of your girlfriend here. What do you do when that happens? Well, obviously you can't go back here and back here, back here. But you can't make this undone. But when you realize, oh, I was thinking of my girlfriend all the time, you go back here, basically. What Uchiyama Roshi says is Zazen means you repeat this. So there's things coming up in your mind, you wake up to this, you realize, I'm thinking, and then you return to Zazen. Return to Zazen, return to Zazen. Maybe over time, just like with, how do you say, carbonate in a cup of Coke. Sometimes it goes in a 5-day session. Usually it gets better after the third day or the fourth day, but sometimes it stays the same until the end. Sometimes it even gets worse over time. If it gets worse, it gets worse. It's really not the point, it's just the point that when you realize your thinking, you realize it and you go back. You don't follow these thoughts, you don't even have to try to cut them off, but basically you go back here. And it's a nice kind of illustration of what happens in the Zen. The only problem is if you take that a little too serious, you're always like sitting with the attitude of a kind of detective in a department store, and you're looking on these monitors and always trying to see is there something suspicious happening, is there a thief right now. So basically you're always looking, is there a thought in my mind, is there a thought in the mind? And when you do that, of course you're already thinking, but you don't realize that this attitude of yourself, I'm the detective, I'm the hotel detective, I'm always looking for some suspicious guy somewhere. You forget that this mindful guy, this mindful detective is the real problem. So basically in this case, you're putting yourself to do that. You need to put yourself somewhere above the line. But like when you say, oh, there's a mind here, now I'm going back. Actually, there needs to be an observer somewhere above the line or somewhere separate from the line. So you think you return here, but as long as the observer is there, separate from that, you're not really on the line. You're always, there's a part of you trying to be in the moment, but then there's also the observer that needs to be outside of there, otherwise he couldn't watch if there's something suspicious happening. So how can we really become one with this and also forget the observer? And I think that's why we have these 5-day sessions and why we have sometimes really hard practice, which is maybe not so hard like what the second patriarch experienced in the snow, but also sometimes we're reminded of that. If you sat through a Rohatsu session in Antares, it's not that we're standing outside in the snow, but you're sitting inside and it's cold, and then sometimes you're actually even doing kinhin outside in the snow, literally. So that has happened. In the summer there's no snow, but again you get to that point where even this doesn't happen anymore. You don't have the time anymore to play the detective. And maybe that's what he's talking here about when he's saying in the Nishijima translation, he was like this because he did not see the means of purity as a means. Basically, there was no more time or no... You couldn't even think about anymore. Oh, there's my mind here, and there's some dirty parts, and there's some clean parts, and I need to do some soji in this area here. But it's just his whole being was absorbed there in that moment. So he had no choice than to just be completely there in the moment, or he could have left. Of course, he could have said, "Well, I leave." I don't even really know who that Bodhidharma guy is, some kind of strange Indian who has just arrived in China and supposedly had communication with the emperor, but even the emperor didn't get him, so now he's sitting there in the cave. Why do I risk my life here and stand in the cold? So he could have left, but he said, well, if I don't make it here, then my books, I didn't find it in the books, even my teacher told me, you need to meet this Indian guy who knows what he can teach you. So I think at one point he was just so absorbed that he couldn't even think about purifying his mind anymore or doing stuff like this, like, oh, there's a thought, now I let it go. Oh, there's another thought, I let it go. He even let go of that kind of practice. That's how I would read this strange part here. I can try to find it in the Shasta Abbey translation as well. following day, the ancestor suddenly had a stabbing headache. We had that. The midwinter weather was cold, for it is said to have been the night of the ninth day of the 12th lunar month. Even if there had not been any great snowfall, a winter's night deep in the mountains atop a high peak is not the time or place to be standing outside someone's window, as you can well imagine. For it was that time of year which is so dreadfully cold that the joints of bamboo would split open. Notwithstanding that, a deep snow did indeed cover the earth, burying the mountains and concealing the peaks, as Eka sought his way, plowing through the drifts. How dangerous it must have been. He ultimately reached the ancestor's quarters, but the ancestor did not give him permission to enter. Indeed, he did not even bother to turn around and look at him. That night, Eka never dozed off or sat down or took a respite. He stood firm without moving, waiting for the dawn to break as the night snow continued mercilessly on, piling up layer upon layer until it buried his waist. His tears froze upon his cheeks as they fell drop by drop. Catching sight of his tears only led him to shed more tears, and reflecting upon himself only led him to reflect more deeply upon himself. He thought to himself, even in the past, some of those who sought the way would break their bones to get at the marrow, or prick open their blood that they might succor those who hungered for it, or spread out their hair to cover the mud, or throw themselves off cliffs to feed the tiger. Those of old were just like this, so what kind of person am I? Thinking in this way encouraged him to be more and more resolute. We trainees of today must not disregard his remark. Those of old were just like this, so what kind of person am I? The moment we lose sight of this, we sink into eon upon eon of delusion. By thinking in this way, his resolve to search for the Dharma and to seek the way only intensified. In that, he did not treat the purity that resulted from his cleansing himself in this way as my being pure. So that's the sentence I'm kind of a little bit puzzled about. And again, this translation is puzzling as well. In that, he did not treat the purity that resulted from his cleansing himself in this way as my being pure. It was possible for him to be pure. Basically, what in regard to Zazen, if you're really one in the moment, and there might still be thoughts coming up, or maybe there's no thoughts coming up, but at that point, there's no detective anymore to check that. So if during Zazen you think, oh, now I'm really in deep samadhi and there's no more thoughts coming in, I'm doing really good. So I would give myself, say, 97 points in a 1 to 100 scale. Then probably there's still a problem there. There's still this kind of school teacher watching yourself and saying, oh, my class, now they're all in order. It's like the shepherd who thinks, now I got them all on the fence, but next minute they will jump over the fence anymore. So when you're really there on the cushion and your life, you put down your life and you say, and even if it costs my life, I'm going to sit here and nobody's going to move me. And then there's nobody to judge there anymore. So how did they have it here? In that, he did not treat the purity that resulted from his cleansing himself in this way as my being pure. It was possible for him to be pure. In that, he did not treat the purity that resulted from his cleansing himself in this way as my being pure. It was possible for him to be pure. Again, not super simple, but that's basically the way I take it. In the Japanese, actually, the kanji are pretty simple, but it's not easy to understand. So setsu no so to so to sezaru. So means to purify. For some reason here, there's also a character for snow. So the purifying snow, the purifying of the purifying snow, he didn't take it as purifying. He didn't take the purifying of the purifying soul is purifying. Therefore, he did it like this. So once more, if you in your mind you're really here, you're here really here down on that line, you didn't even notice it anymore. To get there, from my point of view, you need to a little bit like what in the Bible is called this the hole of the needle. So it's more than just kind of looking upon down on yourself like a detective and always, oh, there's a thought, oh, there's an emotion, or there's something. I'm awake of it now, I let it go. I'm aware of it, I let it go. But yeah, I think you need to go through a needle hole at one point. And that's what exactly happened to the second patriarch when he was standing there in front of Bodhidharma's room. Ska ari keru nani beshi, chime no yoru no shousoku, hakaran to suru ni kantan mo kuda kenuru ga gotoshi. So when we think about what happened to him at dawn of that night, kantan ni mo kuda kenuru ga gotoshi. What do the English translator have there? To surmise what that night of slow dawning was like is enough to break one's innermost heart. To imagine what it was like that night as dawn approached is enough to burst one's gallbladder. Probably that one's the more literal one. Kantan o. Kantan o. Kuda kunulu gagotoshi. Bursting the gallbladder. Literal translation of Dogen's writing here. Tada shimmo no kanha seraruru nomi nari. How do you say in English, goosebumps? Is there a word like that? I think they're sort of saying like something like that. The hair on one's body simply bristle with cold fear when you think about the second patriarch. The hair on one's flesh simply bristles with cold and fear. And then the second patriarch turns around and talks with him. Shall we do that part as well, or shall we stop here for today? Well, maybe, I don't know if you have any questions. If you do, this would be a good point to stop, and we would continue next, maybe not next month, but whenever, maybe one point in August or at the end of September. Because of the summer, I'm not quite sure when the next teacher is. Probably I'm going to give a talk during the retreat, but I don't think it's going to be about this. It could be, I mean, we could talk about the dialogue between the first patriarch Bodhidharma and between Eckhart. Yeah, maybe for today I'll finish here. これ今からがあのまあボディダルマがようやく振り向いて、タイソエカに声かける場面ですが、まあ霧のいいところなので今日はここまでして、次の消防元族用事の提唱いつになるかちょっとわからないけれども、まあ、今日はここまでして。ご質問等がありましたらどうぞ何でも聞いてください。So if you have questions or comments, please feel free to ask whatever you like.
So in your own experience about the needle and like staying in this in the line, in this midline.
Yes.
So, but there will be. There comes, but in this moment where this happened without like observer, that still there is a possibility that building up, or and you come out of this.
Okay.
So
So possibility of building up, what do you mean?
Building up these like little, like the swords still like runs you over and you get out.
Hmm.
And there's again an observer who finds this out and go back to the needle. To the needle point. What?
I mean, there's lots of different things happening during the Zen. So maybe in the beginning you start basically like what Uchiyama Roshi writes here. Like you sit there, there's things happening in your mind. At first you're not aware. You try to have your mind in the present, but then your mind wanders off. After a couple of minutes you realize, oh, I wandered off, so you bring it back. And then you tell yourself, oh, next time I need to be more mindful. And, but then 3 minutes later, again, you're somewhere off, you bring your mind back, you do it over and over again. Then there's also, but there's also times where you really have no choice but to be in the moment. For example, when the pain is so big that there's actually no possibility of your mind going somewhere else because the pain is so big. And in such moments, well, the amount of thoughts, other thoughts coming up is really small because, I mean, the pain is so big. So there's a Zen like that, or sometimes there's a Zen which is kind of like Samadhi-like. You're really here right now, and if there's something coming up, it's really like bird sounds or something, but it really stays in the background, the thoughts, but they don't take you anywhere. You're concentrated in the mind. But then there's this kind of business as usual zazen where you're not in some samadhi, also the pain is not so big, so there's thoughts coming up in your mind, and sometimes they take you away for a while, but then you come back. But then this normal, so-called normal zazen can be a little bit more relaxed in that you're not, I mean, there's thoughts and you awake to the thoughts, become aware of the thoughts, you let them go, try to return to Zazen itself. But there's not this, like sometimes when you're in this detective mode, it's almost like there's two detectives. Like there's the first detective waking up from time to time, oh, I was thinking, and letting the thought go. And then there's the second detective who's kind of judging the first detective for being too slow and you don't work too much. And how come there's still so many thoughts? How, like, often we do this, like, judge authors, and today it was not so good and I should do it better. And how come that after 3 months in Antaishi I'm still at this point? And how come that after 3 years I'm not enlightened and stuff like that? So it's kind of the second detective who's the biggest problem. It's not that we should always be mindless and just sit there and everything's going to happen by itself. It's not going to happen by itself. So you need, of course, to be also awake. And when you think, when you're in your thoughts, you need to, of course, awaken to that and try to get back. And sometimes I say it's also okay to watch the breath and to experiment like this, but the actual problem is this kind of second guy who's making this judgment. Okay, this time the Zen is good, my mind was clear, and the other time was not so clear.
When I look to myself, and sometimes there's, like you said, there's no other possibility, and like I need to stay now here in the moment, otherwise I go crazy and everything is too much. And it's pain like hell. So it's the only gate I have to do it, but then but still I know that this is a gate, and it's my kind of makes the thing kind of easy But I also know, and I need to be aware that I sometimes then it's happened like out of like something a thought comes and then oh fuck, was this horrible? This is horrible. I need to go out. And come back. But still, there is all the time something. Also in the moment when I'm kind of aware and it's like good to sit here, because I'm with the pain, it's like when I'm aware of the pain, it's easy to sit. But I need to be, what is this? This is still I am there and I'm aware that I don't go out of this state. This is this first guy, this shouldn't be the second guy, but there's still like something that like be aware that I don't go out.
Be aware that I don't,
that I don't lose myself on this line. So I'm aware, like there is still like something of a detective, maybe not a detective flow, but I don't know where the next step should be. Like I still think there is a detective, but
I mean, like some people, they talk about these phases where there's no perception at all. So there's, I don't know, that be samadhi or what you would call it, where for an half an hour or maybe a full hour they don't hear anything, they don't listen anything, but there's only clear, crystal clear consciousness, or sometimes there's even consciousness. They say they're not sleeping, but their consciousness is completely empty. I never really experienced something like that, where I would just sit and everything, basically the light goes, all the external input goes out, also no thoughts, but there's only crystal clear consciousness. But that's also something that a lot of meditators report. But in that case, obviously, there's still some consciousness, some awareness. And you might not call that then the I, but well, the fact that people report then later, at that moment, I had only crystal consciousness. Obviously, there's some connection that they make to their.
You also need to stay up on one point and go out. So
Yeah. Even after like maximum 5 hours, people need to go to the toilet. So
yeah, and realize I need to go. Otherwise, like
something needs to take them to the toilet. Yeah. So from my experience, there's always consciousness as long as I'm not sleeping. I'm always conscious. Of course, there's different ways of this consciousness. Like, for example, probably that also has to do with the fact that sometimes the Zen is very long and sometimes very fast. It's usually the Zen is long when you kind of process all these things coming in the mind. If there's kind of the second detective who's kind of trying to categorize all this stuff and then trying to keep track of what is happening. While if you're still conscious, but you're basically always in the moment, and in the moment itself, it doesn't feel as if time is running fast. But then when the bell hits, it's wow, that was 1 hour. It can't be 1 hour. You kind of, you're conscious, but there's no separation. So you're in the moment, and if you would look at the clock at the point, or if you would watch your breath at the point, it certainly wouldn't feel as if the clock is moving faster or if your breath is going faster. But if you look back on that 1 hour when the bell hits, it's like that can't be a whole hour, or sometimes happens after 5 days or session. That's the end of the fifth day, it's just started. Well, sometimes a session can be like, wow, 7 years or whatever. it also has to do, of course, how painful it is for you. Usually the more pain you have, the longer it feels, and if it's very enjoyable, then it sometimes feels faster. But this, I don't think it's the only thing. It's also this kind of the distance. Well, when you're in pain, you try to create the distance, but if you create this distance, then somehow you you process that time in a different way. While if you're really in the moment, and well, if the Zen is for you enjoyable, then it's easier to get into the moment usually. Then even though you're 100% aware in the moment.
But is it really 100%?
or I don't know.
No, I just like for me it sounds like when I think about it, it could be also like you have this line, but you're coming like for my own experience, you're coming closer to it,
yes,
and closer to it. But still, like I've never reached like just a beginner, but I can't really imagine that I'm really like what I right now said. Ah, okay, wow, it's good. I'm it with the pain, and it's really good. But still, there's these. I know that it also could end soon in a way, and then I'm like, so there's these little things still, like my feeling of this watching, and maybe not like in other hours, but there will be a point like when I really reach the line in your theory, kind of. Or it's still like maybe 99% or 98% to.
I don't know, because I'm not kind of witness to yours or Zen.
No, just of your experience. Just of your experience. Like what you like. Do you think that this is like to have the picture of the guy sitting in the room, and then get the screen? That this is like better than the picture of coming closer to the line but never reach the line.
I would say that there are moments where you're really one with that. There's the sound of the bird, and it's not like, oh, here I'm sitting the Zen and there's the bird outside right now, I'm hearing the bird, but it's just the sound of the bird, for example. And that feels definitely different from where, oh, there's a voice right now, I'm hearing that bird, now I let it go, or there's a thought in my mind, now I'm doing the Zen here, so I have to let that go. So I'm not sure, but I wouldn't say that in principle it's impossible to get to that line, that you can only get infinitely close, but you can never reach the line. I would say, of course, there's times where you really want. Really won, but at that time, just like what maybe he's trying to say with this purifying, if your mind is pure, you even lose this idea of purifying. It's when you're one in that moment, there's nobody who's touching your shoulder and say, hey, now you're one. If that happens, like if you think, oh, now I'm there, I'm on the line, then you're not on the line anymore. But I wouldn't say that in principle it's impossible to really be on the line. I think it is. It's not necessary probably that we need to be there 24 hours a day. Maybe it's not even possible, but it's possible to get there. I would say.
Is there something that could help us engage with the story of the second patriarch as an example or as a guidance rather than a fairy tale?
Well, it's basically, I think, our story. And I think when Dogen reads it, he reads it as his own story. I mean, I don't think that Dogen literally had some kind of strange feature there on his skull or so. I mean, that's more or less of a fairy tale, but there's this guy who's really serious about finding the answer to his big question, and he's read a lot of books, he met a lot of teachers, but still he can't find the answer there. And he gives it a last try to see if that funny Indian guy that people tell all these rumors about, but he's been sitting for 9 years there in front of the ball, doesn't even really know who that guy is, but he gives it a last try and has his doubts and thinks about leaving, but then, well, we don't know if he really, the snow stood up to there and how cold it was on that night. And later there's this that famous story that will appear later here, that famous picture of can you see it? In front there's a second patriarch, and here he's holding his left hand, kind of that they say he cut it off, and that's when Bodhidharma, the first time, he looks around. By Sesshu, kind of. I don't know if there's if Sesshu had the intention, but if you look at the rock behind, it reminds me of the painting by Munch, Edvard Munch, The Cry, where it's kind of almost looks like a manga, and here you've got two eyes and this big mouth. I don't know if it was intended like that, but it's almost seems like the rock is kind of expressing this existential pain that probably many people that come to a place like Antaishi or that's search for the way they experienced it. So of course there's lots of things that make it sound like a fairy tale, but probably they try to help us too. That's a kind of manga by a guy called Toyo Kataoka. Yeah, that's Bodhidharma being Kimochi Wari. Oh, that's disgusting. Bodhidharma thinks it's disgusting. He said, Kondake Konjo Miseleba Ikura Dharma to wa Iye Iya to wa Ima. So if I show him my determination, that even Bodhidharma can't refuse me. And then Bodhidharma, that's this, how do you say, that's this famous, or does it go, yeah, I can do that too, but my thumb has just moved. And the Saint Patriarch says, well, give me an answer quick, if I go to the doctor now, they can still. Take me as a student, take me as a student. And the Bodhidharma is crying, says, Yada yo, no, I don't want it. Kichiga no, I don't want to do it. I don't want to have to do anything with crazy people. I have enough of these crazy people. Well, so we don't know if that story with a cut off arm is true or not, but it's basically symbolizing the strength of determination. We don't know if it's a historical truth that's been disputed, or some people say that maybe he had a handicap from birth and later they either he himself or his deshi, his disciples said, well, he cut off his arm to become. Like there's this famous story of Joshin-san, the nun that became a disciple of Sawaki Roshi, and at first he didn't want her, so she cut her a little finger like the Yakuza do. And that's probably a true story, although I don't know, what I heard, it was some kind of rusty knife and took her all night long to cut off the fingers. And I had this Dharma brother who, he cut off the tip of his finger with the circular chainsaw that we have in the Makigoya.
Like Ochi.
Fun?
Like Ochi in the weed machine.
Exactly. So a part of it, and he lost the nail of it. And a couple of years later, when nobody knew anymore about the accident, he would tell his kohai, well, it was just like with Joshin. So I cut my finger to demonstrate my determination. So sometimes, even in a couple of years, people create these legends. You don't have to take it all at face value, but I think basically when Dogen's reading that story, he reads it as his own story. And I think when we read the Gyoji chapter, we need to try to make the relation to our own story there.
But can we develop such a dense determination as a second patriarch, or is it nature rather than nurture?
I think you should. I mean, that's, I think, that the point that Dogen is trying to make when he said, well, of course, these stories of these bodhisattvas that threw themselves off cliffs and stuff like that, I mean, those are stories, but I think Dogen's energy is serious when we say, even we now today should think back of these examples and ask ourselves, well, who am I? Who am I to complain about? It's been too hot in the summer, too cold in the winter, and Sebastian's food is not so good. And, he's sitting there with the beer on the beach, and I'm
in the Hondo,
while I'm doing my best here. And then, so So, I mean, even at the time of the Buddha, there were people like Sebastian, but that's not another excuse to not do yes. Yeah, under pressure.
Under pressure.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe some people are like that by birth and others are not, but I think Dogen tries to motivate us to get to that point where you say, I'm going to die on the cushion, or I'm going to die in the rice field, or I'm going to die in the kitchen. I'm just going to do my best. I'm going to give my body and mind.
Just it seems hard to develop the same kind of intensity. Rather than just look at it as, oh, that's a funny story.
Yeah. It's probably not easy. Not easy. I mean, that's why he's using all these hyperbolic examples. If it was easy to... Well, what Uchiyama explains there with this one line is comparatively easy. Now you sit on the cushion and there's a thought coming up, maybe you don't realize it at once, but when you realize it, be aware of it, let it go, return to the Zen. That's something you can do, but get to this point where you really let go of body and mind, even if it might cost your life. That's not so easy to do. Once you do it and you look back, then might even look in retrospect, it might look easy, but when you're standing there on the top of the 100-foot pole, it's certainly not easy to make that one step.
Yeah, it seems like Uchiyama's approach is a bit more practical. It gives the steps, and here we are kind of encountered with this person that already is sort of godlike determination to do whatever it takes. Could it be easier to stick to more practical approaches rather than try to expect of ourselves to be this kind of...
Maybe. I mean, if it's easier for you, then stick to something which you would call practical and see how far you can get. You might realize that at one point there is that you get to the point which in the Zui Monkey would be called the top of the 100-foot pole. You get there. And you get there several times, whenever you try to get there, you get there, but the so-called practical approach might not help you to do the one last step.
So there is no connection between the practical approach and the...
I think that at one point you need to make a jump. You need to take a jump. And the practical approach only tells you to how you get until the end of that jumping board or whatever.
So what could it be, the thing that could push us over this board?
Desperation, I would say. Sheer desperation. If you realize there's really nothing, no other way for me. I don't even know if this last step will help me or not, but I tried so many things in my life, nothing worked, and this might be my last chance. And then, out of sheer desperation, you might take that last step. While if you think, oh, there are so many other possibilities that I might want to check out first, well, then you need to check those out first. But if you get to that point where you say, well, there's no other options anymore, I've tried everything, then you need to take that step. So, to me, it feels a little bit almost like you're suicidal. You're a little bit suicidal. So you think there's really nothing else that holds me, and I have to
basically exhausted all the other options of trying to make things better or to realize some connection with whatever that is. So there's this desperation, which kind of pushes one over.
There's desperation, yeah, like you have some doubts, some questions, some problem that you want to solve, You need to solve that. You tell yourself, or you get the strong feeling, I can't live my life like this. Maybe I'm going to live like this for 80 years, 90 years, 100 years, but what use would be living like this for even 150 years or 200 years? I need to somehow solve this problem. And whatever it is. So some people would say that there's no meaning in my life. I need to find meaning in my life or whatever. I have to find an answer to the question, who am I? Or whatever. People formulate it, express it in different ways. But you have this some question, and you have the strong feeling that life isn't worth living if you don't find the answer. But you haven't found the answer yet, and you've looked it for it everywhere in all of the books. You've met people, you've tried this way or the other. You never got even close to finding an answer, and then you're at the point where you're not 100% sure, but you have the feeling, well, this might be my last chance. And if this doesn't work, then I might as well die. And then it actually physically or mental, at least mentally, it feels like you're jumping off a cliff. And you need something that makes you jump that cliff, and that's kind of this desperation, or this very strong feeling, I need to find the answer. And if I don't find it here now, I will never find it. And if you don't have that urgent, strong feeling, then maybe it's still too early. I don't know.
もしかして今の話と重なるかもわからないです。ちょっとよくわからなかったです。今日の内容とその座禅の中身を説明されたのとそのつながりが何だったんでしょうか。
今日のところにこの創設の創をなんと書いてあったかな。創設の創を創とせざるによりてしかあるしかありけりなるべしというちょっと難しいところがあったんですけれども。水野八百子さんではこの創設を心を洗うというふうに説明して、この心を洗うことすらもしなくなったというような説明を確かにつけてると思いますね。これはあの365ページの一番最後の行の下ですね、17。創設は心の汚染を洗いすすぐこと、そういう行事の節操さえもしなかった。要するに二層があの雪の中に立っている時にはもうすでに自分の心を洗おうとか、そういうことすらしなくなったというような。でまあ英訳を見ててもうここはちょっとややこしい訳になっているけれども、私の解釈では例えば内山老子のこの有名なあの座禅の、意味と実際という本の中でこういう図があったと思います。ここはまあ今ここという線であれば、座禅しているといつも心がこの今ここから浮いてしまう。で考え事をする、それに気づいたら帰る。でたまにはすぐ気づかないでいろんなことを考えてしまうけれども、気づいたらもう後に戻れないけれども、そこでまたここ戻れる。気づいたら座禅の方に戻る、姿勢の方に戻る。ただこれをやってもなんかいつも自分の心を観察している別の自分がないとこれはできない。だからこれをやり続けても本当に今ここになりきることはなかなかできないじゃないか。どうしたらここまでいけるかというと、あの二層絵画のようにあの雪の中に埋もれたながらもうこういうことをやっている場合じゃない、自分の心を自分で洗うとかそういう場合じゃない、もう今ここ自分になりきる、もうそれこそ新人脱落するしかしょうがないというところまでいかないといけない。で先からまあそれについていろいろ話している。 あの、まあ、安泰寺は摂氏の3日目だとか、あの、辛い田植えの時だとか、天祖、まあ、忙しい時もそう。いう時はあると思うけど、いつも自分で自分の心を観察して、きれいに磨くとか、そういう場合じゃなくても、今ここ、やることになりきるしか仕方ない。それこそ身も心も奉献しなければいけない。 そこまで行くのにやっぱりある程度志という切羽詰まったところまで行って、もうここ通らなければ針の穴のような、こういうところを通らなければ、何をやったってしょうがないから、もう試しに身も心も手放しておく。
もちろんこの内山老子のこの図間違ってるわけではないけれども、そこを通ってしまうともうこれとはちょっと違うんだよね。いつも意識している自分がどこかにいて、そのことになって、だから意識さえもしないっていうことです。だから言葉にしちゃうと、もうそう、意識したらもうずれているわけだから、そこはその 本当にこの線に立った時は、本人は全くそれに気づきもしない。あ、今なりきってるんだという、そういう意識もない。だから、二層絵科は、雪の中に立った時は、今自分の心が綺麗になったとか、そういう意識もなかったはず。座禅になりきった時には、あ、今なりきってるんだと。 よくできているという意識はない。他にはありませんか? Anything else? あ、明日から接心服装を自由にしましょうか。もう暑いので。いい。 Tomorrow dress codes is free. So, Sebastian style. Under pressure.
I use this t